As the sun goes down in Red Hook, Brooklyn, more than 150 riders from all over the world are preparing to compete on this challenging urban circuit. But they're doing it on brakeless fixed gear track bikes and at night. This is the premier high speed, high stakes cycling event on the planet. This is the Red Hook Crit. Was a birthday party, essentially a birthday party that got way out of hand. What started as a race amongst friends right here in 2008 now spans four cities across the globe and is a true championship series. Here's how it all started. Meet David Trimble. To celebrate his 25th birthday, he organized the first ever Red Hook Crit. Combining traditional road bike racing and alley cat racing, he created a competition that put physical limits and bike handling skills to the test in a format of racing designed to be extremely spectator-friendly and intense. This race doesn't follow the traditional bike racing format. It's like no other competition you've ever seen before. The inaugural event introduced its unpredictability boldly, with a woman, Casey Lloyd, beating all the men, including David himself, and taking the crown.
Did you see who just won?
She won.
Oh my God, the girl won.
She won.
The race became infectious with local riders and grew and grew. 8 years on, and it's long since burst its Brooklyn borders, with both pro athletes and talented amateurs now taking part all over the world. What's the future hold?
I don't know. I kind of take it one race at a time.
Yeah. World domination?
We've already done that.
Yeah. We start in the home of the crit, Red Hook, Brooklyn. Then it's a trip across the Atlantic to London on July the 9th. Estamos en Barcelona on August 27th. And we'll discover who will be crowned 2016 Red Hook Crit champion at the season finale in Milano on October the 1st. I'm joined now by the ultimate guide to the Red Hook Crit. He's won it four times here in Brooklyn and is 2013 series champion, Neil Bezdek. Neil, what is so special about the Red Hook Crit?
A lot of things, but if I was going to say that one thing is special about it, it's the energy. There's energy among the athletes. This is a short race, it's fast, it's multiple laps on a very short course. Cutting across all of it is nervous energy. The riders here are on brakeless fixed gear bikes, which makes it that much more difficult to get around the course safely.
Is there a part of the course that can be the difference?
Yeah, definitely. So I think if we look at the course right here, we have two hairpin turns, meaning of sharp 180 degree bend, followed right after the other. That would probably be difficult on a normal road bike with a bunch of other people around at high speeds. But you put people on brakeless track bikes and everyone wants to win, and it can get pretty dicey. The athletes range from bike messengers to top tier professional athletes.
Who are the ones to watch?
Okay, headlining the women's field is the hands down favorite, Ainara Elbusto. Ainara has won the Red Hook Criterium four times. That's a tie for the most wins in the Red Hook Criterium.
With you?
With me, yeah, that's right. She might pass me tonight. That's what I would bet on. Ash Duban will also be another one to watch. Ash has won the Red Hook Crit before. I was speaking to her before the race, and she said she got hit by a car recently and is racing with a shoulder injury, but she did great in the qualifier, and I think she looks fit and she looks ready to go. This year, the Red Hook Crit is really excited to have Daniel Holloway racing. Daniel Holloway is, without question, the best Criterium racer in the United States, but with a caveat, on a normal road bike. And this is Daniel's first time racing in the Red Hook Crit. He qualified in the top 10. But we'll see whether he's able to make it to the end of the race tonight. Aldo Ino Ilesic, he is quite a character on the bike. If you watch him out here, there's one rider who is head and shoulders above everyone else, and he's actually that tall. He hasn't done the Red Hook Crit, but he got a track bike, and he got a coach just so he could prepare for this race. I think in terms of like raw athletic ability, I'd put him at the top, but it's just a question of whether or not he can handle his bike. Might be kind of like strapping a rocket onto a toddler.
The main races are due to begin, but before we throw to our commentators, is there any quick speak that
sure.
we should know first?
Sure. I'd say the first word that everyone should know is drafting. And
yes.
drafting is when one rider rides very closely behind another rider in order to conserve energy, because the first rider breaks the wind and allows that the person behind him or her to pedal less and gain more efficiency. Corollary to that would be attacking. So when someone attacks, they're riding with a group of people who are all drafting off each other, and they might decide, hey, I want to try to ride ahead from this group, or I want to catch another group up the road. So he or she will attack, will accelerate as hard as he or she can, and then try to join the group up the road, or just keep the group behind him or her away.
Thank you so, so much. The women are about to race, so we're going to throw over to our commentator, Gabe Lloyd.
And here we go. We are underway for Red Hook Crit Brooklyn No. 9, presented by Rockstar Games. So our first lap here, Neil, what are we about to see?
All right, well, so you see these racers, they are riding on a very narrow course. Again, it's difficult for these people to pass each other, which is why that starting grid qualifier is so important. They are setting out on a 22-lap Criterium, which is a type of race where riders complete multiple laps on a short technical course in a very kind of spectator-friendly format. But what makes this one especially interesting is that these riders are doing so on brakeless fixed-gear track bikes.
Right, so they can choose one gear, and that same gear they have to use throughout the entire race. So whatever gear they choose has to be something that they can ride throughout the entirety of the performance, but then also be able to sprint on that gear at the end, but also sprint on this gear for our preem laps. And our first lap here is in fact a preem lap. We affectionately call that the breakfast preem, but it also gives us 3 points towards our championship Red Hook Crit Series. And in the past, Ainara Elbusto has been very dominant in these first lap preems.
Yes, and she's the rider that you see near the front right now. She has a very distinctive green helmet. She's a 4-time Red Hook Criterium winner. And right now, the women are about to complete their first lap. They're gonna have a sweeping left-hand bend coming up right before they pass the start-finish area again. And so this is a mini race within the race. The first person to cross the line on this first lap wins the preem for the day.
That's right, Ainara has 9 preems coming into this race, and it looks like she already has a substantive gap coming out of turn number 10. She's looking over her shoulder. Only the La Clasica women are behind her, but they are not going to be able to close that gap, and Ainara Elbusto has just taken her 10th preem, but a first preem of tonight's feature race. And look at the faces on these women as they're coming through the start-finish line. That is showing us that our pace is very high and that the race is in fact on.
Yes, this can be sometimes kind of a startling way to start a race. You're there on the start line, nerves are high, and then all of a sudden it's going 100% for a complete lap. And so now here the women are finally sitting up a little bit. I think we're gonna see the race settle into its rhythm. But we've got Ainara Elbusto on the front of the race and starting lap number 2.
Yeah, number 2 there. There's going to be a lot of action here tonight as we're going to see a number of teams working together to try to unseat Ainara Elbusto in the green helmet there, but also individual riders like here, Francisca Campos here in your screen. It looks like she might be laying down a bit of an acceleration. Campos is an accomplished bike racer outside of the discipline of fixed gear criteriums, having participated in the Olympics in the discipline of mountain biking. Campos now joins us here on Fixed Gear Crits. It's great to have Olympians joining us. I think we have riders of all sorts of backgrounds here
mm-hmm.
tonight, right?
Yeah, we have top tier road racers who do conventional sanctioned road racing, track racers, cyclocross racers, bike messengers, and in this case right here, Olympic level mountain bikers. It's actually not surprising to see this fast start to the race in the discipline of mountain biking. It's similar to this race where you start on a narrow course and really try to get to the front as fast as you can, and that's exactly what's happening here.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, look at this great perspective that we have in front of the Brooklyn Cruise Terminal where we can see the speed that these riders are carrying throughout. That is Haley Edwards of YB Normal on the front in the white helmet and very colorful kit, contributing to the pace setting in front of the green helmet of Ainara Elbusto. Again, your race favorite here, even though she did not win the grid qualifier that Ashley Fay of Cuncinelli Chrome took. Right now we're behind we're within the field, I should say. Early in this race, it's going to be quite chaotic as the race is being established, and a lot of riders are going to be jockeying for position.
Exactly. What you can even see right now is, you know, this field is already becoming a little bit selective. There are small groups of riders who are trailing off the back, and as the evening goes on, we're going to see the group get smaller and smaller and smaller as only riders who are capable of keeping up, who are fit enough, and who are technically skilled enough to keep pace can actually stay within this group and draft off of the remaining group of riders.
Right, sure. But it is awesome to see so many women out here tonight. I mean, when this race, when David Trimble started the race, there was not, in fact, a women's field at all. You know, we used to have just one field of men and women all racing together, and it was essentially 20 of us in the street.
Right, exactly. Well, so the race organizer threw this race as part of his birthday party 8 years ago, and since then it's really evolved and grown into this global event. And this year is our third year with a women's race, and 50 women participating in the race tonight, coming from all corners of the globe.
Yeah, about 50 women participated here. We have riders here from Europe, South America, the Caribbean, and of course North America, all making their way here tonight. Checking out Vittoria Riotti right now, an Italian rider riding for La Classica. She's in that gray skin suit there, checking over her shoulder. Vittoria Riotti, a very young rider. I think she's 19 or 20 years old, but she is out of the saddle right now, trying to bring the heat to Ainara Elbusto, but Elbusto is not letting Vittoria Riotti get anywhere. And check out the speed of this race.
Exactly. If you look at the riders right now, you can see they're mostly single file, and the shape of the group usually will give you a sense of how fast everyone's going. If the riders are single file, they are just sitting right behind the person in front of them because they don't want to be out in the wind. They want to save energy. When the pace drops, that's when you see the field kind of balloon out, and it gives you an indication of what the speed's like out there.
Yeah, I mean, but we're definitely seeing YB Normal contribute to the pace setting this evening. That was Kira McVitty in the white helmet and the colorful kit leading into the hairpin feature of the course here tonight. But let's talk a little bit more about the course. I mean, tonight we have a 1.1 kilometer lap, and that lap has 10 turns in it. Six of them are left, four of them are right, and yet they're doing these on track bikes. This is anything but your traditional velodrome here, right?
Oh yeah, that's very true. And you know, on a course like this, even on a conventional road bike, it would reward a really technically skilled rider. We have people we're all really fighting for every inch of road to basically be able to take the fastest line around it without making contact, or while making minimal contact with other riders around here. But when you compound that with the fact that everyone is riding a single speed, fixed gear bicycle without handbrakes, it really requires a good deal of fitness and a good deal of skill.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, check this out. We have Catherine Sherwin of Affinity Cycles, a Brooklyn-based bike builder. Catherine Sherwin is on the front right now, taking up a lot of the pace setting, probably for her teammate Ash Duban. Duban riding bib number 4 for her accomplishments in past Red Hook Crit events. Ash Duban won the 2014 edition of the Milano race, actually upsetting Ainara Elbusto. So the Affinity riders in the pink and purple kits are definitely riders to consider for tonight's finale.
Yeah, again, you know what? I think we're already starting to see a pattern emerging here tonight. Ainara Elbusto, again, in the distinctive green helmet, she's last year's series winner, and she is the woman to beat tonight. And all the other riders, mostly, are looking to her to either set the pace of the race or really to control the outcome. So we've seen Ainara on the front a good deal, and I think most of the other racers are expecting something similar from her.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think that Ainara has to really ride aggressively to hold her position on the front, because if she finds herself way too far back, she now has to play defense. She needs to cover way more moves up ahead of her that she would not be able to if she were on the front of the race. But that being said, Ainara does not want to be in the wind too much, right?
Yeah, so the dynamic here is really that if you're close to the front of the group, then that's the safer place to be. There's fewer people in front of you who can crash. you're more likely to be able to take the fastest line through a corner. You can see what's going on. But the problem is that if you're the very first person in front, then you're the one breaking the wind, and you're doing more work than everyone else.
Yeah, but check this out. I mean, talk about breaking the wind. Kiera McVitie of YB Normal once again laying down a nice attack. She was out of the saddle there on the straightaway. She is now rounding through turn number 9 on the front. Ainara Elbusto in the green helmet is right there. But it's great to see Kiera McVitie from London here tonight to really bring the race to these fans. Look at all these fans, 15,000 fans here this evening cheering on what is one of the world's premier fixed gear criteriums.
Yeah, that's right. And now you know, what we see here is there will be groups of people from the same team riding near each other at the front of the race. And there's going to be a lot of team tactics where riders will work together and give what Gabe sometimes calls a 1-2 punch, where a rider from one team will accelerate up the road and force other people to try to chase her down, and then one of her teammates will counterattack because her first teammate tired out the competition.
That's right. So the first rider sets the pace like Kiera McVitie was doing earlier, and then maybe her teammate, any one of the YB Normal girls who are all wearing white helmets and very colorful kits and on Ginelli bikes, another one of them would then accelerate and keep the pace high. What that does for individual riders like Ainara Elbusto is it puts them on the defense. They are forced to cover all of those efforts by multiple different riders. Eventually, the idea is that that individual rider would get too tired to be able to cover all those surges. And here we go, once again, up the left-hand side of the course, YB Normal, trying to put Ainara Elbusto, your defending champion, on defense.
And that's usually what we see at this point in the race. We're about 5 laps in, there's a long way to go. Everyone, you know, coming out of the gate is excited, and they're going to push the pace faster and faster and faster and try to force a selection so that only the strongest riders can keep up.
That's right. I mean, honestly, we talked earlier about the history of this race and how much it has changed, even in the past 3 years, where we've seen dedicated women's fields. The team tactics and individual discipline of the riders at the front has changed so much. I mean, when we started this in 2008, riding in the streets of Brooklyn, you know, we would get out there and just put our heads down until we couldn't see anymore, you know?
That's exactly it.
Now we're looking at team tactics and individual discipline. But when I talk about discipline, Neil, I mean, you know, you followed this series through from the very beginning up until almost last year, right?
That's right.
And you know, you have more accomplishments in these races than almost anybody. Can you talk a little bit about what it means to be disciplined inside of a Red Hook crit?
Yeah, that's a really good question. When we think about discipline, we might think about someone who trains hard or, you know, really follows the checklist. But what we're talking about in the bike race is being smart and being conservative. It's not always the strongest bike racer who wins, but it's the cleverest bike racer. So in this situation, these riders are moving through the course, and people are being very deliberate about when they choose to exert themselves. This isn't just a contest of who can pedal the hardest for 45 minutes. What we're really doing here is being selective about when riders are in the wind, when riders are following other riders, and using team tactics to kind of create an outcome that puts one individual in a winning position.
Right, but I mean, I think there's even another level or consideration in these races in the fact that you can only choose one gear, right? We are on a track bike, so whatever gear we choose before the race even begins determines how we may perform. Can we talk about like some of the discipline that's required to understand what your individual ability is within these races and how that affects what our gear choice might be?
Mm-hmm. So every woman before she starts the race tonight is going to choose a gear, or basically what speed or how hard she has to pedal to go a certain speed on the bicycle. And this is a really critical choice. Unlike a normal road bike, once you're out there racing, you can't change gears. You're stuck with whichever gear you chose. And someone might choose a different gear depending on their tactics. If a rider expects to basically race conservatively and win with a single surge in speed at the very end, she might choose a much higher gear, which is a little bit less efficient but gives her an ace up her sleeve at the very end of the race. Another rider who might decide that she's going to solo away from the field and going to have a steady race without a high speed will choose something a little bit lower because she's going to choose her winning speed to be a gear that carries her at the same speed.
start to finish.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I mean, but some of the things I find so challenging about these types of races, especially on these courses that David Trimble designs, you know, David spends a lot of time designing courses that are going to force the riders to slow down, right? And slowing down becomes as much a part of the race as speeding up and going fast. And part of that course design is for rider safety. You know, when riders are forced to actually control their bikes, you know, there's a lot more that goes into the forethought and thinking a couple turns ahead. Right now, just getting back to the action, Jasmine Doty is definitely contributing to our pace setting here. Great to see Jasmine Doty, an Italian bike racer here from Italy, definitely trying to bring the heat to Ainara Elbusto. And look at the field, it's just completely
right, and you could already see a lapped rider there getting pushed to the side of the course. Their pace is so high that as some people drop behind, they can't even get out of the way of the oncoming group. But we've got periods of aggressive racing, and then the group will sit up, and then they'll be aggressive again. In a couple laps, there's another preen. That's the mid-race dinner preen that usually affects a little bit of the plot of the race, you might say.
Yeah, the race dynamic gets changed a lot when there's that mid-race preen. I mean, not only are there a lot of really good local goodies to be had in that preen box full of amazing food and intelligentsia coffee, but there are also 3 points up for grabs for the Red Hook Crit Championship Series event. Talk about the evolution of this birthday party to a bike race. We now have 4 races across the globe. The first one is here in Brooklyn. The next one is in London on July 9th. Our 3rd race will be in Barcelona, Spain. And our series concludes in Milan, where Ash Duban here on the right side of your screen actually won in 2014. So the points are awarded to riders who cross the line first for these preem laps, and that you can see the pace is definitely heating up as we approach our mid-race preem.
Exactly, and here you had Ash Duban. She was attacking, now just holding space in the front. I think riders here, they're just watching each other. They know that points are on the line, and you see Elbusto looking over her shoulder. She wants to keep these people in check, and she's sending a signal, don't you dare pass me, because I'll chase you down.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, one rider I've noticed here at the front of the race a little bit more often now that we're getting to the midway point, local rider Chelsea Mateus. She's there in the blue and black kit. She's been a little aggressive. I've seen her throw some elbows, but that comes from her sprinting background on the track. It'd be interesting to see how this local rider in her first Red Hook Crit does against some of these very disciplined and experienced road racers and fixture Criterium racers here. Yeah, it's going to be really interesting. There she is on the right side of your screen as the pace is definitely increasing. Neil, where are we on our race here?
We are approaching the halfway point. This is soon going to be a preem that they're sprinting for. You know, if you look at this handlebar footage, you know, what looks like it might be a friendly environment is actually pretty aggressive and pretty frightening. These riders are all using every single inch of road that's available to them, and they all want to be close to the front. They don't want to be breaking the wind, but they want to be near the front and in a position to respond to things. And that means that they're bumping elbows and they're taking some risks out there.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that is the art of these criteriums, is to be near the front, but not necessarily on the front. And when you see Ainara Elbusto here in the green helmet on the front, she's not putting a lot of pressure on the pedals. She's only riding hard enough to stay near the front, but not putting in an effort that's going to put her into the red, as we say. You know, an effort that's going to tire her out so much that she will no longer be in contention. But check this out, Ash Duban on the front in the pink and purple kit, riding for Affinity. She's got her head down. She definitely is trying to increase the pace as we head towards our mid-race preem. That looked like Chelsea Mateus in 3rd wheel and one of the La Classica women in the gray skin suit in 4th wheel. So check this out, fully strung out, and a lot of action.
Exactly,
yeah.
Look at this. They have a small gap. Now it's the riders are all single file. When you see these gaps open up between riders, that means that people are struggling. They don't want that gap to open up in front of them, but sometimes they just can't pedal hard enough. So we're at a point now, riders are starting to get tired. Elbusto's looking over his shoulder. Ash Duban here takes a fast line around the outside. They know that points are on the line coming up soon.
Yeah, I mean, now we are heading into our preem lap, right? So this is not the lap where we award the points. The next lap will be, and all these riders are jockeying for position, looking at each other. This Chelsea Mateus on the front looking at Ainara Elbusto. We are on board right now with Kim Lucy of State Bicycle Co. in the teal kit. This is a great perspective to see what it's like to be on the front of a Red Hook Criterium when the pace is on. At the finish of this lap, we will now see preem points awarded and the dinner preem basket going to whoever crosses the line first.
Exactly, and now here we are, we're approaching the hairpin section of the course, so there are two hairpin sections. First, a 180 degree right-hand turn. Again, these riders are on race bikes without handbrakes. It's difficult to change speed and get around these safely. And positioning around these turns is so important. So notice Ainara Elbusto here taking the inside line. In general, the rider who's on the inside, who wins that race on the inside, as we see right here, gets to dictate the turn through the corner. She can determine the speed and she can take the safest line. If someone's crowding her to the outside, it's easy to push someone to the outside from the inside. So here we go. We are approaching our mid-race preem.
Yeah, Kim Lucy is of State Bicycle Co. in that teal and black kit is trying to shake Ainara Elbusto from her wheel, but it's a pretty long way out. I mean, this is a 1 kilometer lap, which means that 500 meters is between her and the finish line, and check that out. Ainara Elbusto in the green helmet has just come around Kim Lucy. They are now within 300 meters of the start-finish line, and Elbusto is clearly in command. We are on board Kim Lucy right now behind Ainara Elbusto. Let's see if Elbusto can hold on for the mid-race preem here as they come through turn number 10. Look at the battle for this preem out of the saddle, giving it everything they've got. Kim Lucy is closing ground a little bit, but Ainara Elbusto holds on for that mid-race preem, securing 3 more points for the championship series and taking home a box full of goodies from local Brooklyn producers here. Brooklyn Red Hook Crit is on, Neil.
That is right. Now, these racers, you see, they just sprinted. This group is a little bit tired, but they also just put some distance between themselves and the group behind them. This mid-race preem is often where we get a bit of a selection. The riders really push the pace as much as they can, and you get a group of people who often just can't keep up.
Yeah, I mean, check this out, this teamwork here by Affinity Cycles. We just had Catherine Sherwin on the front, and you can see from this inboard camera that Ash Duban has now gone to the front. She is trying to continue the high speed. Vittoria Riatti in third wheel there behind the green helmet of Elbusto. These three women are going to continue the pace setting here, and look at the gaps, Neil.
Oh yeah, these riders are struggling. Anyone who's further back, who you just saw coming through the turn, the leaders are barely in sight for them. And this is a point in the race where your heart rate's as high as it can go, and you can barely keep your bike upright. And to look all the way up the road and see these people powering away can be a little bit intimidating. So it'll be interesting to see if this group that we have now can maintain its gap again. Here we go, another rider attacking,
yeah,
and Ainara Elbusto right on top of it.
Yeah, Kara McVitie of YB Normal is contributing once again to the pace setting. It's great to see McVitie on the front so much this race. I think she will definitely be a contender for our Rockstar Top Antagonist Trophy this evening. That award is given out by race director David Trimble to the racer who is so aggressive throughout the evening that you cannot miss them, and so far, Kira McVitie has been that rider. In the past, though, we've seen Fleur Farr, the French woman, win that award multiple times, but tonight we have not seen Fleur Farr on the front. We have seen Kira McVitie, so it'll be very interesting to see if McVitie is able to keep her intensity up the rest of this race with about 10 laps remaining, more than halfway, and the pressure is really starting to be brought to the front of this race. Look at the selections being made here.
Yeah, and you know what? Even if we haven't seen someone, I don't want to be too dismissive. For example, on the last shot, we just saw Joe Celso of the Team Cinelli Chrome outfit. She won the race in 2014 in the pouring rain, which takes some gutsy riding to do.
And in this situation, a smart rider just waits and waits and waits. And you want your rivals to forget about you and let the rivals beat themselves up and tire each other out and then pounce. So, you know, right now we've got a few key riders animating the race, but we could have someone zoom up from the back and really change the dynamic.
That's right. I mean, there's always a surprise in the Red Hawk Crit event where, you know, a couple years ago in the men's field, Thibaut Leary won in the pouring rain. Nobody knew who he was. He attacked very late in that race and was able to hold on for a victory. He went on to become a very dominant rider in this series, but you know, the women's field is new enough that that similar sort of surprise could definitely take place here tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, one thing that's unique about this race is that it combines riders from multiple disciplines. And so in dedicated road racing, people usually end up racing against the same people over and over, and they know exactly what to expect from them. Same thing is true in mountain biking, same thing is true in track racing or cyclocross. But with the Red Hook Crit, we bring together all these people, and there are a few familiar faces, but sometimes you never know what someone's going to bring to the event.
Yeah, that's right. And that's also why, you know, riders like Ainara Elbusto just patrol the front of the race continually, because she does not want to let any surprises just roll up the road. You know, she's not going to take any risks. She's going to try to control this race as best she can, because that's the tactic that has worked for her so far in all of her previous starts. Again, she has almost more wins than you, Neil.
Well, it's only a matter of time, I'm afraid. But, you know, I think that what we're seeing right now is, you know, a group of about 20 women at the front. We're all very smooth, and they're, you know, working well together. And it looks like, you know, as the race goes on, it comes down to a contest between a smaller number of people.
Yeah, I mean, these selections will continue to refine themselves as we get deeper and deeper into this race. We're under 10 laps remaining. You know, one of the riders I haven't seen so much tonight is Sammy Runnels. Last year, she was on Affinity Cycles for this Brooklyn event, contributing to the pace setting for her teammate, Ash Duban. I mean, talk about a reversal of roles. Tonight, Catherine Sherwin has been an excellent teammate for Ash Duban, contributing to the pace setting. And Sammy Runnels has been almost nowhere to be seen. That's very interesting. I mean, you know, I'm not sure if that's just displaying the increase in ability in these fields or what, but here we go. And as an example, Affinity Cycles is coming to the front once again. You know, I think the washing machine effect, as you've talked about,
yeah, exactly,
is contributing here.
Sure, and it can be really tough for these people to stay at the front and, you know, basically preserve their position without what Gabe referred to as the washing machine, where riders from the back will cycle to the front and push you to the back, and cycle from the back and keep pushing you out of position. And it can make it really difficult, or at least you have to pay very close attention just to stay away from the people around.
That's right, but I'm loving the aggressive riding of Kiera McVitty there. Man, when she came through the start finish on that lap, her head was down, she was grit, giving it everything she had, just to keep the pace really high, because she knows that's the only way to try to unseat some of these favorites. But check it out, Ash Duban putting some pressure on the pedals as they head into the technical hairpin section. This is a perfect place to really put pressure on the rest of the field, because the rest of the field has to negotiate against other riders around them, whereas the riders on the front can really dictate their own line and really dictate their own speed. And if they want to go fast, they can go fast because they have any line available. Whereas if you're back here in the field, you have to ride around other riders.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Gabe. And again, because these riders are on brakeless track bikes, if they do have to slow down to maneuver around other riders around them, it just simply costs them more energy. So the riders in the front here, we can see, have a clear advantage. Even right now, three riders pulling away.
Oh, yeah. That is a really good advantage. It looks like we have three riders, Ainara Elbusto, Ash Duban, and Vittoria Riatti, it looks like. And it looks like Kiera McVitty has joined them as well. So we have a quartet of riders off the front at the moment, but it looks like Fleur Farr is actually trying to bring that back together, Vittoria Riatti's teammate. Interesting team tactics there by La Classica.
Exactly. Well, also, you know, a couple key teams have missed the move. I don't see Team Tonelli Combe here, so it looks like one of them further back trying to chase this group down. If you see riders up the road and you don't have a teammate up there, that's when it's time to hit the panic button. You don't want to let them ride away. So even though we have, looks like, five of the strongest riders right now pulling away, the riders behind them are going to be very, very motivated to bring them back.
Actually, we were just on board Kim Lucy, who just made the junction, who has just brought herself in. We are right behind Flora Farr at the moment. So it looks like this front selection is growing on every pedal stroke. It looks like Irene Usabiaja has made her way up there as well in that teal kit riding for polo and bike. You know, I think she might be that dark horse that we were talking about earlier. You know, Jasmine Doty might be someone, but this is Irene Usabiaja's first Red Hook crit. She's on the Spanish national team. Again, she's in that blue, very bright blue kit riding for polo and bike. Irene, she's got a lot of experience on the road, but that doesn't always translate well to a Red Hook crit.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting to see the athletes who do the best always have some sort of racing experience. They're used to being in a high pressure situation with high speed, but it's not always the dedicated road racers who do the best, or it doesn't necessarily guarantee success. There are plenty of experienced road racers who show up to this race and can't always function in this unique environment.
Yeah, I mean, I can think of plenty of men that we've raced with over the years who are very accomplished on the track or road or whatever, and they come to these races and they just can't perform.
Yeah, and sometimes they expect to clean up, which makes it entertaining as either a fellow participant or a spectator to see that. You know, you can't rest on your laurels when it comes to the Red Hook crit.
Yeah, definitely not. Oh man, this is awesome. So we've got Catherine Sherwin on the front, definitely laying the speed down. This is such an awesome perspective from Kim Lucy right now to show the speed that Catherine Sherwin is bringing to the front of this race in the purple and pink kit riding for Affinity. Looks like we are right behind Kira McVitie, it looks like. So yes, the front of this race is going fast, single file, ladies and gentlemen, through the start-finish line. The end of the race is near.
That's right. We are down to 6 laps to go, and this is the time of the race where everyone is thinking solely about the finish. And every rider, in her mind, is coming up with the plan. Am I going to attack up the road? Am I going to try to get away by myself, as you see Ash Duban doing right now?
Yep.
Or are we going to wait, and we're going to hope for a group to roll into the line together and have a field sprint? So as time goes on, people are going to be very, very conscious about where they are on the road relative to other people and trying to stay close to the front and making plans for the finish.
Right, I mean, and also as the aggressiveness within the field increases as each lap counts down, you're going to see a lot more of this washing machine effect take place. I mean, you know, riders at the front right now, like Ash Duban, who's really doing an amazing job keeping the pace super high. Only Ainara Elbusto is able to hold that tempo. Back in the rest of the field, you have riders who we saw in the front a couple laps ago. They're nowhere to be seen right now.
Exactly, and Ash knows that. Ash is pushing it hard because she wants to shed riders. She wants to go to the finish line with fewer people with her.
That's right. The fewer people you bring to the line, the higher your chances are of ending up on the Red Hook crit for podium here tonight. But it looks like our field is whittled down from the 50 starters that we began with, but we still have a lot more than 5 riders here, and only 5 riders will end up on our championship podium. Check this out, Kira McVitie once again on the front. Just amazing performance by her tonight. I would definitely vote for her as a Rockstar Games top antagonist winner.
Yes, absolutely. But again, the pattern that we identified at the beginning of the race is still holding. Ainara Elbusto, she's doing what's called welding. She's keeping the front of the race together, because my guess is that she wants everyone to come together as a group. She's a good field sprinter, and she's good at positioning with a tight pack. So Ainara is very rarely hitting the lead herself. She's only waiting for people to accelerate by her, and then just slowly closing the gap and waiting in their slipstream. So this is a way that she can ensure that no one gets away, but she keeps herself close to the front of the race and saves as much energy as possible.
Yeah, you know, I think it's really amazing like how Ainara is able to just rock the field position in these races. I mean, every single lap we've seen that green helmet there repeatedly, whereas we see many different riders behind her churning through their positioning. Elbusto makes this look so easy, and I can assure you that it is not. Every lap, it is a fierce fight for the front, and Elbusto is just showing everybody how it's done.
And as the race goes on, it's a fierce fight that people are waging with less and less oxygen in their system. And you know what we see as the race goes on is that early on there tends to be some chaos. People kind of settle into a rhythm, settle into an order. Right now we're at a point where really only the most capable, the most experienced, the most fit riders are at the front, and they're kind of ordered mostly relative to their ability. Whoa. So we got some bumping there,
yeah,
but usually at this point in the race, it's the more skilled, safer riders who are around, except what's going to happen is they're all going to get more and more aggressive. So in the closing laps,
yeah,
even though it's the best racers, they're pushing the limits of themselves and their bikes.
That was an amazing perspective we just saw there. We were on board Kim Lucy as she attacked up the Collins Strickle straightaway, And man, that was cool to see. She was really far back in the field and she just laid down the effort up the right-hand side of the track. Amazingly enough, Elbusto responded, but Elbusto is not actually directly on the wheel as we're coming into four laps remaining.
Yeah, it looks like Elbusto might be in a little bit of difficulty here. She's been working hard all race long. I've got to wonder how many more accelerations she has left in her legs after covering attack after attack after attack. She's in a good position right now, but I think she's going to be a little bit tired.
Right, but it'll be interesting to see if Elbusto actually wants to contribute to Kim Lucy's pace setting here. I mean, Kim Lucy, again, in the teal kit on the front, we saw her attack about half a lap ago. If Elbusto continues with the pace setting, that could be really dangerous for the rest of the field.
Yeah, exactly. And again, here we are coming into the two hairpins in succession. And you actually see, you notice as we come around each corner, on the inside of the corner, there are small orange cones. And these are one of the unique safety elements of the course that are custom designed only for this race, that are meant to give riders a visual line around the turns, which especially at this late stage in the race is so important as they're all positioning really aggressively.
Right, as you talked about, that oxygen deprivation really affects your judgment late in the race here. And so having these orange cones kind of guiding you through these technical turns on a track bike is very helpful. That is an amazing safety precaution taken by David Trimble and Trimble Racing crew as a whole. A new addition here for our 2016 edition of the series. But let's talk about our race right now with Kim Lucy of State Bicycle Co. She has now been on the front of this race for 1 kilometer, and you can see she is no longer able to turn those pedals over.
Exactly. You know, this is what you might describe as a little bit of a calm before the storm. Everyone's thinking about making a massive rush to the finish, and they're all conserving their energy because they know that the last couple of laps are going to be chaos. So you see people sit up a little bit, they catch the breath, always looking over their shoulder to see the group spread out wide across the road because they know they're coming into a really crucial few laps here before we lift the pace again.
That's right. These last three laps, everyone kind of brings a sigh of relief for a brief moment, but you know those attacks are about to begin because this is the moment where you must be in good position if you want to contest for the podium at the end. Ainara Elbusto checking over her shoulder, looking at Haley Edwards in the white helmet there of YB Normal. Behind her, we see Ash Duban in the pink and purple, Ashley Faye in the yellow and red, and I saw, we're looking at Irene Usabiaja here, polo and bike, a lot of top contenders. Checking out Brooke Phillips here, actually. We haven't talked about her too much. She's on the yellow bike right in front of us right now. Brooke Phillips in town from London. Great to see out-of-towners here contributing to the pace setting. Talk about a dark horse. Brooke might be one of those here tonight.
Yeah, at this point, you know, I'd say it's anybody's race, or at least anyone who's in this front group right here. I think I wouldn't be surprised if we start seeing a rider try to go up the road. Not everyone is a good field sprinter. Not everyone can just wait to the final charge to the line. And at this point, it makes sense to try to accelerate away from the main group.
That's right. I mean, not everybody is a field sprinter. And you know, if you've made it this far and you're part of this front group and you think you've got a shot at holding on to an effort, maybe now is the time to attack and see if you can hold on, because if you don't think you're going to end up on the podium anyways, why not give it a go?
Exactly. And you can see the pace picking up here right now. Everyone's, they know we're getting close to the end. Everyone is accelerating into the turns because they want to have a good, safe line through each of those corners.
Right. Now, again, we're talking about teamwork right now. Catherine Sherwin on the front for Affinity Cycles, trying to help her teammate Ash Duban out, who we see on the right side of her screen right next to Chelsea Mateus, a local Brooklyn rider. Teamwork here is going to be interesting because we don't have full lead-out trains like we see in some of the other events. You know, it's just pairs of riders. So they have to be very selective about their efforts as we get into these last two laps of the race.
Exactly. But what you'll see is, you know, at this point in the race, riders from the same team will kind of tend to link up. You see the why not the normal girls riding together. And that's because it's so difficult to preserve space for yourself on the road that if you have a teammate next to you, it's much easier to preserve space for yourself.
That's right. We're seeing Fleur Farr there on the front of the race in the gray skin suit, riding for La Classica, presented by Speed Gang. Fleur Farr, again, a former winner of our Rockstar Games Top Antagonist Trophy. It's great to see her finally on the front of this race, and maybe she's been conserving herself for the finishing sprint, although it is a little bit far out. I don't know. I, I'm, It's exciting, Neil. Exactly. I don't know what's going
to
happen.
This is the time of the race where we'll be able to see who's exerted themselves too much, who has nothing left in the tank, and who's actually been playing it really conservatively and has an ace up her sleeve.
Definitely.
Right now, again, Ainara Elbusto on the front, looking very comfortable, looking over her shoulder. And she does so, she's not only getting information about who's behind her, but she's actually sending a message. She's telling people, don't you try to pass me. If you do, I'm just going to chase you down. I'm going to get in your wheel. It's not going to be to your advantage. So she's really telling them, this is my race. Don't you pass me.
Man, I am super impressed right now with Brooke Phillips and that yellow bike and Kim Lucy here, who we're on board. Or actually, we're on board with Brooke Phillips right now. Very impressed with her. You know, she's raced such a great event. It's great to see her here with the lap and a half remaining to be part of.
Oh, rider down.
And that was, it looks like. And we have another rider down. Wow,
oh,
I was
no.
just trying to figure out who crashed the first time, and now we have another crash down. Looks like we have about half a dozen riders. The green helmet of Ainara Elbusto did make it through there. Wow, utter chaos here. The Red Hook Crit, Brooklyn No.9, as we're coming into the last lap of our women's feature event. Again, we saw two crashes there at the top end of our course, but the green helmet of Ainara Elbusto, the white helmet of Vittoria Rialti, and the pink and purple of Ash Duban safely made it through the, and we have a couple Why Be Normal girls there as well. Man, what a finale here tonight.
Yeah, you know, it looks like about six or seven riders made it through that crash without having to slow down. They kept their speed going, and these is really coming down to these last six. A few riders got through behind them, but they're using all their energy to close the gaps. And so here it is, this is your selection. Right now we're looking at five riders coming through the last hairpin turns. Now around the sweeping bend, this is a critical moment right here. Everyone is thinking about the finish line, and they know that that final crucial turn is coming up.
That's right, we have a selection of five riders. Two of them are YB Normal girls. Kira McVitie and Johanna Janka are there. Johanna Janka has performed very well in Germany this spring, winning a couple of her local fixed gear criteriums and the rad race there, which is definitely an amazing accomplishment. But I'm seeing that blue kit of Irene Usabiaja coming up the right-hand side. This
is the straightaway into the final turn. This determines the race right here. Whoever comes out of that final turn has a big advantage. This is the critical moment.
Yeah, but check out the speed of Ainara Elbusto right now. She has a gap over second place Ash Duban right now as they thread the needle past that crash that just happened.
And this is your sprint to the line.
That's right, Ainara Elbusto was on the front. Let's see if she can take it, and she does. It hands in the air, the green helmet of Ainara Elbusto. She has taken one of her most impressive finishes here in Brooklyn tonight at Red Hook Crit presented by Rockstar Games. What an amazing finale here this evening.
Congratulations. Dígame el sprint final, ¿cómo fue?
Pues bueno, fue un sprint que en la vuelta anterior se había habido caídas. Entonces pues se ha hecho un poco raro el sprint, pero bueno, ha sido bastante rápido. Yo venía controlando ya en las curvas que sacaba un poco ya de distancia allí, me veía bien. Y bueno, a tope ya desde a falta de 100 metros.
Y él, tú dices que no tienes miedo de nada.
No, la verdad que en la bici me transformo un poco y se me quitan todos los miedos y tengo bastante habilidad para coger las curvas, entonces se me da bien.
What a way to start the 2016 Red Hook Crit. Ainara Elbusto is the winner of the women's title, and we'll see you shortly for the men's event. Welcome back to the Brooklyn leg of the 2016 Red Hook Crit. If you've just joined us, you missed Ainara Elbusto win the women's title, but the men's will begin shortly. Now remember, they're riding brakeless fixed gear bikes around this very technical course. It's over to Gabe Lloyd, our commentator. Enjoy.
And we are, here we go. We are off in Addison Zawada, very clearly starting off with an amazing gap from front of the field. And it looks like our race moto is stuck. It's just in the middle of the race.
It's stalled. Yeah. Riders going down
everywhere.
Left and right.
We've got riders all over the place. You know, just absolute chaos here. Riders just, I hope everybody in there is okay.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that was not planned. The looks like the moto stalled and the race started.
Yeah.
And first rider was able to soar by, second, third was able to do the same thing, but as time went on, each rider had less time to do it.
Here we are, so we're going to restart our race once again. We are going to have a 22-lap race here tonight. Addison Zawada on the front, qualifying in her number one pole position ahead of an entirely stacked field of riders. This has been quite the night for everybody, but we are excited to have you here. Fabio Scarazzati in the gray La Classica presented by Sportswear Kit on the front heading into the hairpin turn. You can see these guys, their speed is very high on this first lap.
Yeah, the first lap is really critical. Everyone's fresh. Everyone wants to get up the road and not get caught behind crashes. This thing is going to be full speed, 100% out of the gate. And not that they need more incentive, but there's also a preem at the end of the first lap.
That's right. Our first lap preem here is brought to us by a lot of our local Brooklyn sponsors and Intelligentsia Coffee. But it also awards 3 points to our Red Hook Crit 2016 Championship Series. And Mario Paz Duque, who has won many of these first lap preems in that pink kit there with the blue face mask, has taken many of these premiums, and he looks determined to take his first lap premium here in Brooklyn tonight.
This is Mario's signature move. Mario's from Columbia. He is currently a professional road racer in the discipline of sanctioned road racing, but he has a BMX background, so he's good at that really fast, short effort, and it looks like he's in a good position to take our first lap premium. Look at this, we already have a separation of three riders off the front. And you know what, these guys, they know there are already a couple crashes. They just want to get ahead as fast as they can and get out of trouble. So this is full gas right here. We already have a group of three. They're looking back, seeing who's behind them.
That's right, Ed. So I'm checking my history sheet. It looks like Pazuke has just taken his seventh preem overall in these races. So that's
the history
impressive.
Of the crit.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yes, but so Mario Paz Duque is taking 3 points for himself for his 2016 championship. But check this out, William Guzman in the black kit. He won London last year. He has made the split. But check this out, LA specialized rider in the white, Aldo Ilesic, a professional Criterium rider, making his Red Hook Crit debut, has already established himself on the front of this race.
Yeah, you know, this is actually really interesting because most of the guys we're watching right now, these are veterans of this event. They've been around the Red Hook Criterium. They know how it works. They know how it's differentiated from other conventional road racing. But Aldo Ilesic, the taller rider in the white and black kit, this is his first Red Hook Criterium, even though he's a very seasoned professional. I think there's been a lot of people wondering how he would do tonight. He looks pretty comfortable to me.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it looks to me like he's got a pretty smooth cadence there. He must have been practicing on his track bike a little bit. It looks like our field is back together. I'm seeing Addison Zawada, though, in that teal skin suit sitting about third wheel. Great to see Addison staying up front in the chaos that is the first few laps of Red Hook Criterium.
Exactly. We are two laps in, and we are going single file. This race, again, is at full gas. You see the riders are single file. Means that the riders are going pretty much as fast as they can. It's very difficult to move up the side of the road as we see a rider doing right now. Usually when the race is single file, it means that the pace is high, and when the pace drops, it balloons out.
That's right. I mean, the fact that Addison is on the front of this race right now, setting the tempo in front of this stacked field of international riders, it says a lot about Addison's improvement. I just wonder if Addison's going out a little too early. I mean, look at all the guys that are behind him. I know Addison qualified in the pole position, taking home $200 for his effort here this afternoon. But man, we got a long way to go in this bike race.
Yeah, well, you know, the way it goes with bike racing is if you're the first person, you're breaking the wind, you're exerting yourself a lot more than everyone else. But on this course and with this race specifically, you can't just sit up and take a rest and move all the way to the back of a big group, catch your breath and move forward again. This race, positioning really matters, and if you want to end at the front, you got to do most of the race also near the front.
Yeah, but near the front is not on the front, and when you're on the front pedaling hard like Addison is currently doing once again, I just wonder if that's a little too much of an effort. But I mean, because you're seeing the riders behind him, so the rider in third wheel right now looks like possibly Marius Petrage or even Biganzoli, either rider. Both riders are on Team Cinelli Chrome. Very talented European riders. Biganzoli is an Italian rider. Marius Petrache is a Romanian rider. Both have extensive professional backgrounds.
Yeah, exactly. This race, you know, it attracts top level riders from all sorts of disciplines: mountain biking, cyclocross, conventional road racing, track racing, and especially there is a lot of interest from like seasoned professional road racers. And you know, as we watch this race, not just the speed and the intensity, but I think we're going to see a lot of tactics that are very, very similar to top level riders. Oh, and rider down.
That was Addison Zawada there. I was just about to mention his positioning there would look pretty good to me, actually. But I told you guys about how Addison was riding very aggressively early on. I wonder if he just put himself into too much oxygen deprivation too early, you know, and just, you know, made a silly mistake.
It's actually very possible. I think one thing that differentiates this race from others is, you know, riders, they don't need to exert energy just to maintain speed. They also have to exert energy to slow down. So if you're pushing yourself really hard and you're tired, you have to use energy to slow down those pedals to actually change your speed. And if you're tired, if you're exhausted, then you enter a corner with too much speed, down you go.
Yeah, I mean, but man, talk about professional racing tactics. These guys heard that crash and they took advantage of that scenario immediately. When Marius Petrache and Aldo Ilesic went to the front and just laid the hammer down immediately, trying to take advantage of the nerves within the field here. Whoa, check this out. That looks like Colin Strickland going up the right-hand side. We are on board Colin Strickland right now, and look at the speed that Colin Strickland is bringing to the front of this field. My goodness.
Wow, this is an aggressive move by Colin. He won the race in Milan, Italy last year in 2015 with a solo effort. He went up the road by himself, and he was able to keep his gap until the end. But a little bit early in the race for a rider to be getting out by himself. We'll see if someone rides up and joins him.
Well, we'll see. I mean, we're on board Daniel Holloway right now, 10-time U.S. Criterium National Champion. Holloway is obviously very experienced in these types of high-speed, high-adrenaline events. Holloway knows that Strickland is dangerous, as both of these riders have competed against each other in the U.S. Professional circuit. But Strickland, man, he is establishing a gap quickly and smoothly here. And wow, we are back on board. It looks like Strickland again. Yeah, so wow, big gaps here.
Yeah, and now you see again, that's still Daniel Holloway chasing Colin Strickland. So
yeah.
One of Strickland's main rivals in this race, Daniel Holloway, experienced rider. He's going to take responsibility for what happens here. Someone's getting away who doesn't want to get without him. He's going to try to chase him down, but it looks right now like that gap is pretty steady.
Yeah, I agree with that. And, it'll be interesting to see if Holloway's fitness is going to be able to keep Colin Strickland in check. That is definitely Holloway on the front, but check out who's on his wheel, Aldo Ilesic.
Yeah, that's right. And that is his teammate. They wear black and white kind of mirrored opposite kits, but they're both riding for Specialized on these custom one-of-a-kind bikes they made just for this race. But what Aldo is doing for his teammate up the road is he's sitting right behind anyone who would chase him. And so what happens is, if the person chasing, which a moment ago was Daniel Holloway, finishes, he's going to sit up. And then the only person to take over is Colin Strickland's teammate. And he just rides nice and easy through the turn. He's not going to chase down his teammate. He's just going to discourage other people from chasing him.
Yeah, but with so much horsepower in this field, I can't imagine that these guys are just going to sit by and let somebody just roll away you and Dan Chabanov just riding off the front, you know?
Yeah, well, no, there's definitely some firepower further back, and these are a bunch of very hungry, I might even say rapid bike racers, and I don't think they're not going to let someone ride away without a fight.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, especially after Strickland really upset the Italians in Milan at the end of our 2015 series by countering the mid-race preem. I think the Italians are going to be really motivated to keep this race together tonight.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, here we are with some onboard footage, and you can really see that these riders are riding so perilously close to each other. It takes just a tremendous, not just a tremendous amount of guts to ride out there, but really a tremendous amount of trust in the other people who are racing with you. And even though, you know, it might look a little bit tranquil, I can assure you that that's not a friendly environment. Those guys are all fighting for every single inch of road that they can get.
Yeah, I mean, on the left side of your screen there, you're already seeing dropped riders who are no longer in contention, and we're only a handful of laps into this race. And yet we still are seeing Colin Strickland's gap being maintained there. We're looking backwards right now. I think we're on board Alec Briggs, who's a very talented rider from London. you know, Briggs would definitely be somebody to watch, but look at all the guys who are around him. I mean, Marius Petrace, maybe that was Ignacio Moser or Alvise Zanosko, two very talented riders on Bahumare in those red and white kits. I mean, again, there's so much firepower in here. I can't imagine that Colin's going to be able to hold on to this effort.
No, but, you know, he looks smooth, and he's an experienced racer. He knows what's ahead of him, and he's going to pace himself for this long effort. I would say one thing that is working in Strickland's advantage right now is this is a very narrow course, and so the number of people who can actually kind of break the wind behind him and set the pace is relatively small because riders can't change much position. So this really right now is kind of a race between Strickland up the road and only a handful of guys behind who are actually able to break the wind. And since he's by himself, he can take the fastest line he wants through corners. No one's getting in his way. He gets to ride his own race right now.
So what do you think it would take? I mean, how many riders in front of Aldo Ilesic would it take to, like, change the dynamic in the field behind him?
So that's a really good question. When riders chase another rider up the road, the way that they do is they take turns, they rotate, they work together. So one rider will be on the front, he'll break the wind, what we call pulling, for about 30 seconds, and then rotate off, and then the rider behind him will take over. And then another rider behind him will take over. And there's a rotation of multiple riders. So I'd say you need at least two or three guys working together to pull this back. But if you have a rider like Aldo who's just sitting on the front there, he's more likely to break up that rotation. And what he's doing right now is fair game. It's what he's not. People can pass him if you want to. He's just not being very helpful because his teammate's up the road.
Yeah, so there's a certain rhythm that occurs within a field that if you break that rhythm, that can have very interesting ripple effects down through the rest of the field that can really change guys' lines through turns. They can change their efforts in and out of turns, which affects their mental state as well. And, you know, unfortunately, because of the earlier incidences tonight, I think we've got a lot of nerves. We've got
absolutely
a lot of physical things going on. So, I mean, this Strickland might just be taking advantage of the nerves.
No, absolutely. I mean, he's struck while the iron's hot. He's been away for three laps by himself. Look at his gap has grown. Those people are out of sight.
Yeah.
And, you know, another thing that might be working in Strickland's favor here right now is that while he is a strong rider, he won the last race in Milan, there are some very, very prominent favorites in the race behind him. And those guys are still worried about racing each other more than they are about chasing Strickland. There's 15 laps to go, there's a lot of racing left. And so if you consider someone who's back there like Ivan Ravaioli riding for Team Chalantrone, he won the series last year, and other people who maybe would, you know, be inclined to chase Colin are saying, no, I'm gonna make Ivan Ravaioli chase because he's the other favorite. And then they're waiting, and that's the reason why Strickland's gap is growing.
Yeah, sure. I mean, that's a great point. Ivan Ravaioli last year, he won Brooklyn. We were surprised last year, but by the end of the season, we were no longer surprised. Ivan just put on so many amazing skills clinics for us every single race on how to ride proficiently and smoothly and absolutely in control. And one of the things that Ivan does is that he's comfortable waiting for the finishing sprint. He will never be on the front trying to pull somebody back. He's comfortable letting the field do the work. Now, tonight that might be a gamble though.
Oh, it's always a gamble. I mean, you can never control with absolute certainty the outcome of any race. You just have to size up a situation and know your strengths, know other riders' strengths and incentives, and then ride with a strategy on what you assume the outcome is most likely to be, but there's no certainty. And right now, what's looking most likely is that Colin Strickland looks very good. He is coming through with a lot of horsepower. Yeah, they better get organized behind him.
Yeah, they better. I mean, at this point, I mean, Colin is showing no signs of slowing down, which is just interesting. I mean, we should talk a little bit about the history of this race, I think, at this point, because what I'm remembering, and as I kind of mentioned before, is days in the past when you, Sir Neil Bezdek, and our other friend Dan Chavanagh.
Yeah, that's right.
Used to do this exact same thing to us in the field.
Yeah, sure. It's, you know, I think, this race has evolved, and I think one thing that was true about it in its early days 8 years ago, and still true about it now, is that, you know, this brings together a lot of riders from different disciplines who don't always know each other. So sometimes the race will have a little bit of an unpredictable outcome because instead of encountering each other every single week like road racers do with other road racers, or like mountain bikers do with other mountain bikers, we're bringing all these people together, and there's a little bit more of a wild card. And so the dependability or the kind of
reliable outcomes that people might expect in other disciplines aren't guaranteed in the Red Hook Crit.
Yeah, I mean, I was in the race in 2012 when Dan Chabanov rode away from a field that was full of guys who, you know, we all thought we were pretty good at that point. You weren't there because you were racing professionally on
sure.
the road that time. But, I mean, we had Francisco Martucci in there. We had some other Italians who came in. It was right when a lot of the Europeans started to come to Brooklyn to race. And we were here at the Brooklyn Cruise Terminal. And when Dan went early in that race, we were like, nah, no way, dude. No, but no way somebody can hold on to that gap. But that was very different from what we're seeing here today. I mean, the level of rider that's participating here tonight is, I'd hate to say, but exponentially different.
Oh, absolutely.
From when I was there.
Or just, it's not maybe that the individuals are higher, but it's that really all 100 people on the course are super fit, super experienced, popular road racers.
Yeah.
And, you know what though? Colin's putting on a show tonight, and we'll see if they can close the gap. You know, I think I wouldn't be surprised if as he came into this race, this is his move. And you know, if you watch his pedaling, his stroke, he is pedaling really efficiently. His legs are moving very quickly.
Yep.
And when riders approach this race, they have to make a very difficult decision, which is what gear they're going to use. Because they're on fixed gear, single speed track bikes, they can't change gears. And they have to select a gear that will take them through the entire race. And that means they have to choose a gear that they're going to use when they're going relatively slowly around these hairpins, and then when they're going relatively fast around the straightaway. And so a rider might choose a certain gear depending on his riding style, or depending on the weather conditions, or depending on what he expects his competition to do. And Colin here, he's chosen a gear, so his legs are moving very, very quickly. He knows, I bet he was planning on having a long solo effort, and he can just cruise along in a gear that would just be really comfortable for him.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, so let's talk about the course here tonight. It is a 10-turn course, 6 left turns, 4 right turns. All of that adds up to a 1.1-kilometer loop. This is anything but velodrome racing here, ladies and gentlemen, because even though we're on track bikes where you have to choose your gear, and that's the gear you live with, as Neil just talked about, you have to turn right and left, you're dealing with wind, you're dealing with all sorts of different scenarios.
And the biggest difference is speed changes.
Yeah.
So this is a course where there are a couple long straightaways, riders get going really fast, and then there are hairpins where riders go slowly. And the difference between this and, say, a road bike is that because riders have to actively resist the pedals to slow down, they actually have to use energy to slow down. So a rider who can ride smoothly and efficiently will save energy simply by being efficient, not even because they're perhaps more fit.
Right. I mean, yeah, there's so many considerations that go on here before the race even begins. And that's really what's kind of amazing to me, though. I mean, David Trimble has designed these courses to be safe for the riders by forcing them to slow down as much as they speed up, right? Because when you slow your bike down, you have to really understand what you're doing with it, especially on a track
bike. Yeah, absolutely. You know, there was actually a group of people who were out in this area, which when the race isn't happening is a large cruise terminal and kind of a large piece of pavement. And like, there was a team of people who were simply riding bikes around this open lot, trying to configure the best course. And we were giving thought to what would make the most exciting and the most interesting race, but one that would also, really be designed with rider safety in mind. So everything on the course is really designed with safety in mind, even though, of course, as we know, bike racing just carries a certain degree of risk that we can't escape.
Yeah, I mean, there's inherent risk in any sport, whether we have fixed gears or handbrakes or anything else.
All right, and here we have Mario Pazduki was just moving up the left side of the road. I wonder if he's going to start chasing here. We're at about the halfway point of the race, and Colin Strickland is not slowing down. And you see a relatively large field behind, and so, given that there's still maybe, about half the field left at this point in the race, means that I think we could pick up the pace. These guys are capable of going faster.
Yeah, I mean, we're definitely seeing our paces increase. I think that's Olivier Leroy there, showing himself at the front of the race. But what I'm really surprised about is that I'm not seeing what I consider, aggressive attacks up the gutter. You know, like riders cutting across the course out of these hairpin turns and just pinning it repeatedly, because Aldo Ilesic is only one guy, and
right.
He only has so much energy, and it's an entire field at this point against two guys, and I'm kind of astonished here at what we're seeing.
I mean, yeah.
You know, we're seeing two riders completely control a field of probably 50.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and I think, you know, it might look easy here when, you know, we're just watching it from
Absolutely. The
stands, but, you know, every single guy here, his heart rate's high and his adrenaline's flowing, and, you know, I think part of it is that if there are moments when the race is really difficult, as soon as you can catch a breath, you catch a breath. And I think, you know, instead of having a little bit of what we might refer to as more of like a yo-yo where the race goes really fast and slows down a bit, Colin Strickland, he can ride at a steady pace, and you know, that's also working to his advantage right now.
Right, yeah, but I mean, the crowd is loving this. I mean, look at them banging on those boards there and how everybody is just really, really into this show that's being put on. We're seeing our field come through past the Brooklyn Cruise Terminal, and check that out. Aldo Ilesic just on the front, looked like a leader bike rider on the very front of the race, but I mean, nobody is able to get around there. It looks like we're actually behind Ivan Ravaioli right now because he's wearing number 1.
Yep, so that is last year's season winner who's just pulling away. And if you pay attention, he's always positioned perfectly. He's always gonna be about 5 riders back. Ravaioli has years of experience as a top-tier professional road racer in Europe, and he knows exactly how these things work. And the art of keeping position in a group is something that he has really, really perfected.
Yeah, I mean, Ivan Ravaioli has started in the classics like Milan-San Remo, and I think he even has a Giro d'Italia start.
Yep, that's right.
So, I mean, he's... Talk about pedigree here in the field, but my God, look at that. Like, Colin Strickland is a full half lap in front of the rest of the field at this point.
Yeah, exactly, and you even see his position there on the bike. He's resting his forearms on his handlebars, and he'll probably put his hands on the drops when he's going through the turns, but he's doing that because it helps improve his aerodynamic position. So now his hands are back down the side as he approaches these hairpins, but his main focus right now is being as steady and as aerodynamic as possible.
Yeah, steady state, but at a really high threshold as well. You know, it's not like he can now cruise. I mean, even though he has a half a lap advantage, that half lap advantage can very quickly come down if there's organization behind him. So at no point can Colin really ease up.
Yeah, and that's often the way that these things go. Just because he's got a big gap right now, riders, you know, early on, experienced bike racers know not to panic. You get yourself into trouble when you're panicking. So you just wait and you wait. And you know, 8 laps is still a long time. They could definitely chase down Strickland. And as time goes on, they know that you know, they have less opportunity. And so I bet we're gonna see more of a concerted chase, and we're gonna see Strickland's gap go down. So he really needs to keep on the gas if he wants to make this move work.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're looking at guys like Mario Pazduke here in the pink. Definitely a rider to consider. You can see that he's pulled his face mask down and that he's definitely getting ready for the finale here as we come in. This is a La Clásica rider in front of us now as well. Looks like these guys, you can see they're skidding their wheels as they come into the hairpin turn. That's a tactic that I never really perfected.
Sure, yeah, no, it's not easy to do, but sometimes you gotta slow speed as much as possible. And if you lock up your feet, it actually, you know, slows down the bike. It's similar to grabbing your handbrakes, and it's a little bit less demanding than if you just kind of keep your pedals moving. But
yeah.
You see here, we are still single file. Riders are struggling. The pace is on. I think we're going to see this gap starting to come down.
Yeah.
I don't know who it is on the front, but someone is definitely putting pressure on right now. They want to catch Strickland.
Yeah, I mean, you know, look at the pace of these guys. They are definitely not out for a Sunday ride by any means. So I can only imagine that Strickland is about, his gap is going to dwindle here. So he really needs to stay on the effort if he has any chance of surviving here tonight. Paolo Bravini there on the left. Looks like he's losing some pack position here because I think we're on board Alec Briggs at the moment. Again, our La Clásica rider from London. Yeah, I mean, these guys, wow, they are really moving. Here.
And you will really notice as they go through corners, they're using the entire course. They swing all the way from a barrier on one side all the way to the barrier on the other side. And that's because they want to be able to conserve as much speed as possible. So you see right on the apex of the turn coming out of it. It's really similar to car racing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, actually interesting, this course and this event was actually conceived really with a car racing pedigree. The organizer... of the race, David Trimble, he had a background in motorsports before organizing the Red Hook Crit. So now he has this, oh, there, Strickland, he's excited.
He wants the crowd involved, yeah.
Exactly. But a lot of the elements, the safety elements, the competitive elements, even the artistic elements, have a history in motorsports. So I think here we see a Red Hook Criterium, a little bit of a blend of conventional road racing and car racing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, everything from those little orange cones you see on the ground there to guide the riders through the best line possible to our hay bales to, of course, our brand, course branding. And if you notice, the colors of the course branding change. Sections of the course that have red course branding, that's actually there intentionally to warn the riders that that is a zone to slow down. Whereas the black branding is set up for riders to continue their speed. So there's a very intentional sort of usage of graphics on here to inform the riders, which I find just absolutely amazing.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, if you look, pay close attention on the inside of the course, you'll see a lot of course marshals. There are about 20 different staff all around the course on radios with flags. And they're really just trying to keep the course safe, keep pedestrians off, and then communicate with each other in case there are any incidents.
Yeah. So here we are in our last few laps of our bike race, where I think we're behind Daniele Carragherin. He's riding for Oscar Cycling, wearing number 6 here. You know, our pack is tight, it's aggressive. The guys are really starting to jockey for position.
Totally. You can see how close these guys are riding to each other. And, you know, we're down at about 5 or 6 laps to go. And at this point in the race, everyone's starting to think about the finish. And they know that where they are in the group right now is most likely where they're going to be as they approach the finish line. So no one is going to give an inch without a fight, and that means the riders are exerting themselves really hard and just fighting for space with everything they have.
Yeah, but I mean, we have significantly less riders here than 100 from when we started. You know, I mean, this is an Intelligentsia rider, I believe. Or is that, no, I'm sorry, that's an Aventon rider, I apologize. Either way, I mean, we're looking at...
We're down to at least a third of this field, and that's often the dynamic. If you can't keep pace with the main group, if you get gapped off the back, and you're fighting to win by yourself, your race is over. It's not gonna end for you well at all. And so we just saw a view of Colin Strickland still out of sight, Peloton sitting up a little bit.
It's these guys jockeying, you know? I mean, we're seeing Ivan Bravaioli and Olivier Leroy and now Daniele Carragherin, like all these European riders here tonight jockeying for position. But that is Enrico Biganzoli on the front, riding for Team Cinelli Chrome in the yellow and red, really setting the pace. He's had it with this cruise, you would say, you know?
And like he's giving it everything he has.
Absolutely.
And he is not doing that for himself. This is a completely sacrificial move. He is giving it everything he has, because his teammates, especially Ivan Ravaioli, last year's series winner, are the designated winners for this evening. And so he's just going to blow himself up simply trying to close the gap that we have to Strickland right now.
But it's going to take more than just Enrico Biganzoli to bring that down. Marius Petrace needs to get up there. Paolo Bravini, they also
the other
need
riders
to get up
from
there.
Team Cinelli Chrome, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, all those guys need to really work together and disrupt what Aldo Ilesic has been doing to the front of this field all night, and that has been just simply sitting.
Yeah.
You know, Aldo Ilesic, you know, like we've been talking about, riders get to the front, Aldo gets on the wheel, and he just sits. Yep. And when that rider gets too tired, Aldo doesn't go around him. He just continues to sit, and he just lets the field go slower and slower and slower until somebody decides to take up the pace setting, and Aldo jumps right on that wheel, and it just starts all over.
Yeah, that's exactly true. And you know what? It's not only up to Aldo. Of course, Colin Strickland here is doing all the work. And at this point, he's probably finally starting to think about the finish. But he's thinking, I cannot let up. Even though he has a sizable gap, nothing is assured right now. And there's this terrifying feeling, like, I don't want to crash. I don't want to catch a pedal. I don't want to wash out a tire. He just needs to get to the finish.
Well, also, yeah, I mean, this is a 10-turn course that is 1.1 kilometers long. So essentially, Strickland still has 4Ks to go.
And here we have two riders off the front. I think they're trying to bridge to Colin Strickland.
Yeah, so that is Alvise Zanasco.
They have shedded the riders behind them. They're saying, we're not waiting for you guys. And they're going to work together to try to get up to Colin Strickland without bringing the entire field.
Yeah, good luck to them, though. I mean, I saw Aldo Ilesic on the front just drilling it to bring them back, because he knows he can't let anybody go at this point. We've gone this far. He doesn't want to let the victory slip from their hands. Hey. And like I just said, 3.5 kilometers remaining, that's a long way to go by yourself.
Yeah, it definitely is.
So Strickland here in his aero position, he's definitely struggling to maintain his speed, but you know, I haven't seen the gap come down, even with attacks by Alvise Zanoska in the red and white. I don't know exactly who that second rider was, but I'm sure their pedigree is great, and you know, because we have so many heavy hitters in here today, and a lot of these guys are here for their first time. Aldo Ilesic, first time. Tristan Yule, rider for Aventon, doing a great job in there. Daniel Holloway, riding for Intelligentsia.
Right, and Tristan Yule, he's an interesting story because he comes to the sport from mountain biking. So while many of these riders are road bikers or road racers or track racers, he comes to it from the knobby tire discipline. Here we are, three laps ago, Colin Strickland, still with a big gap. If you look at his body language, I think he's getting a little bit tired.
Yeah, definitely, man. I mean, that'd be really interesting to see what happens in the field here. But, you know, I'm also hearing that we've got, like, some really good improvement within the field here. I mean, it's hard to see, but like guys like Tobias Lewis on Dos Noventa is here. You know, he's in the front group. Reese Wood from the fifth floor and George Garnier from the fifth floor. They're both in this front group. I mean, that is an incredible accomplishment for a lot of these riders who have been following the Red Hook Criterium series around for years now. They've made an elite selection, a 30% selection of this field.
Right, and you know, anyone can sign up for the Red Hook Crit. It's one of the things that's really unique about it. Not anyone can get into the feature event. They have to make the qualifiers and prove themselves as a racer. But, here we go. Who's moving up the left?
Yeah, it looks like an Aventon rider looks like going up the left-hand side. But you know, we are definitely jockeying for position for our final sprint here. It looks like Team Chinelli Chrome is starting to amass themselves at the front, possibly for an organized lead out. We'll see though if he's going to let that happen. Who is that on the front there? It looks like Aventon. Rider, was that a Cameron Bond maybe?
Yeah, it might have been. And what we're going to see now is you'll see groups of riders from the same team, the same color clothing, grouping together, because as we approach the finish of the race, it gets harder and harder to maintain position. People are fighting for it. And if you ride directly next to your teammates, this is an unspoken rule that other riders will not get the teammate. So we're going to see teams trying to line up as they think about the finish. And the question is, are we going to see someone make a last-minute effort to try to bridge across the Strickland or get away by himself, or are they going to just think about the field sprint here?
Yeah, so I apologize. The last rider we saw on the front there was actually David Santos, rider number 58, riding for Aventon Factory Team. Santos has a lot of experience in the professional field with riders like Colin Strickland, Aldo Ilesic, Daniel Holloway. David Santos is no slouch on a bike. He was definitely
here we go.
To
Mario Pazduke attacking right up the front. He wants to go. He's saying, I don't want to wait anymore. This is my race. I'm going to take it. And you know what? Immediately, we have the veterans jumping right on him. Aldo Ilesic and last year's winner, Ivan Ravaioli. Ivan, he's just waiting. Second wheel. He is the master at positioning in the group.
Yeah, much like Ainara Elbusto in the women's field, Ivan Ravaioli in the men's field is an absolute tactician. He will always keep himself up at the second wheel, never letting anybody else get on there. He's waiting and waiting for that finishing sprint. I think he's waited too long though here tonight.
Yeah, no, I think looks like Colin Strickland, you can see the smile on his face. He's already playing with the crowd. He's still got a lap to go, buddy. You don't want to celebrate too early, but
right.
Wow, look at his gap. That field is out of sight. He is gesturing to the crowd. That's a good feeling.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, like, he still has 1K to go, which can be an incredibly long way on a track bike. But, you know, it looks like he has kept his... yeah, he's getting that crowd going. We see one lap remaining here at Brooklyn. Red Hook Crit number 9 presented by Rockstar Games. He has a full 500-meter gap over the rest of the field here.
Yes, he just needs to drive it home. But what a fight we have behind these guys. They're all fighting for second place. And what we have is, although Ilesic, he's still on the front. He's still keeping the group in control for teammate. But behind him, there is a dogfight going on with Ivan Ravaioli, last year's winner, and also Daniel Holloway there with the light blue shoulders and the navy blue kit and the white shoes. We're looking through his handlebars right now. He and Ivan Ravaioli are going to be bumping bars because they both want to be right next to or right behind Ivan Ravaioli.
Yeah, but it shouldn't be discounted. You know, Holloway has done the professional six-day circuit in Europe for a couple years. So Holloway definitely knows his way, not only on a track bike, but in the Madison, which is an event that has a lot of traffic, a lot of bumping, a lot of actual intentional physical contact. So Holloway's not scared when it comes to these types of tight environments. So we'll see if Holloway can actually hold on to the wheel here. And we come back again to our gear selection. But check this out, Ivan Ravaioli wearing number 1 in the Team Cinelli chrome
kit.
He's
in a perfect position.
They are
two turns and one bend away from the finish. These two, second and third, this is the contest for second place right here.
Absolutely.
Colin Strickland up the road, out of sight. I imagine he's gonna be crossing the finish line pretty soon, but the fight is on behind them. And here he is approaching the final bend.
That's right, Colin Strickland coming through turn number 10. He is about to take Brooklyn number 9 in commanding fashion. David Trimble waving the race winner's flag, Colin Strickland saluting to the crowd.
And here's the approach to the finish.
Oh my god.
Aldo Ilesic attacking in the straightaway before the turn. That is a smart move, but I don't know if he'll be able to hold it. Ivan Ravaioli.
Ivan Ravaioli comes around on the inside in turn number 10, and he might secure himself second place. He is kicking a hard gear right now, and he has in fact taken himself second place. Aldo Ilesic, though, has taken third. And a very dominant team performance here by LALA Specialized.
Absolutely, you saw him put his hands up there, and it's an unwritten rule in cycling that you only post up, you only raise your hands at the finish line if you won or if your teammate won.
Right.
So second place finisher, Ivan Ravaioli, impressive ride, strong athlete. He doesn't put his hands up, but
no.
Colin Strickland and Aldo Ilesic from All I Specialized, they get to celebrate today.
Yeah, absolutely. I thought what was really interesting, though, in the last few laps is you saw the real fight for position there. And at no point did these riders give up necessarily. It's just the fact that Aldo was really able to control these professional riders in this field.
What was your action plan?
Something like that. As soon as I kind of made it to the front, there was a lull and I decided that's usually the best tactic, use your momentum and push through the lull and get a gap and then just head down for the rest of the race. My teammate Aldo just had the front so controlled. There's plenty of power there to chase me down in that field. One or two of those guys could chase me down if they're motivated, but your teammate controls the front and discourages chase.
Here are the race results for Brooklyn number 9. In the women's crit, Spain's Ainara Elbusto takes the top of the podium, cementing her 5th Red Hook crit race title. Ash Durban of Affinity Cycles is runner-up. Third place goes to Vittoria Reati, with Irene Uzabiaja and Kira McVitie rounding out the top 5. So after the first race of the 2016 season, our championship standings look like this. In the men's crit, Colin Strickland of Alele Specialized takes the top spot and bragging rights. Italy's Ivan Ravaioli is second. Third across the line was Aldo Ino Ilesic, with Daniele Cayagarin and Daniel Holloway completing the top 5. Which means our championship standings for the 2016 season look like this. The Brooklyn leg of the Red Hook crit complete. Now we head across the Atlantic to London around 2. We'll see you there.